two, three.
Welcome to or welcome back to my YouTube channel. So as you can tell by the title and the thumbnail, today I'm going to be talking about breeds of dogs for service dog work. So if you didn't know, I have a 9-month-old standard poodle service dog in training. So you can subscribe if you want to see more service dog related content. So without further ado, we're going to get right into the video. I just want to say before we get into it, I'm not a professional. I personally did a lot of research because I'm a big planner. I love planning things. When I was looking into a service dog originally, I did a ton of research. So I'm just going to kind of share the research that I did and the information that I found with you guys. So I'm gonna talk about like the common breeds for service dog work, and I'm gonna touch on the Fab Four and how to choose which dog is right for you. Obviously, it's important to remember that every dog is different and they're not all going to be the exact same. So when you're deciding which breed of dog you're going to get for your service dog prospect, it's really important to keep in mind what you need. Don't just choose like a husky because they're pretty. Like, you really have to make sure that the dog is going to check the boxes that you need for your service animal. So first I'm going to talk about the Fab Four. So the Fab Four, for those of you who don't know, are Golden Retrievers, Labrador Retrievers, Standard Poodles, and Smooth and Rough Collies. So what the Fab Four is, are the four most common and successful breeds for service dog work. It's super strongly recommended that you get one of the Fab Four instead of getting what's called like an off breed. So a breed that is not one of the Fab Four, essentially. The first breed we're gonna be talking about is Golden Retrievers. Obviously, when you think of service dogs, you probably think about Labs and Golden Retrievers. So some things about the Golden Retriever is they commonly have a really high energy level. It depends on the dog's personality, obviously, and the bloodlines and all that sort of thing. But generally speaking, they're pretty high energy level. Sorry if I'm looking down, I have my notes. They also have a really high prey drive. So this can be a good or bad thing, because obviously you don't want your service dog to be like super inclined to like chase things because they need to work. But something that's good about them having a high prey drive is a lot of times you can direct their high drive, use it for service dog work. Something else about the Golden Retrievers is they're very trainable. So they're really good for first time owners. They're generally just a good solid dog, and they can be really successful with owners who don't have a ton of experience with dog training. Something else is they need lots of exercise. All of these dogs obviously need exercise. Golden Retrievers definitely need exercise, like probably 1 to 2 times a day at least. That can be really hard if you're a disabled handler, so that's something to keep in mind. They also shed a lot. They have a gorgeous, beautiful coat, but that comes with its consequences. They shed a lot and they do need like some grooming maintenance. Okay, another thing that can be like a good or a bad thing in my opinion is they love people. So you're probably like, how is that a bad thing? What I mean by that, it's not ideal to have a dog for a service dog that like really is inclined to go see people a lot. And that's something about Golden Retrievers, is they just love everybody, generally speaking. You don't always want a dog who's like gonna want to like go greet people. That's something you can train them to not do. They can also create really strong bonds with an individual person. Next, we're going to talk about Labs. Labs are pretty much the poster child of service dog work. They're similar to Golden Retrievers, a lot of the same stuff. They still shed a lot, but a little less than Golden Retrievers just because they don't have as long coats. They're really smart and really trainable, and they're all around just like a solid dog. They can be really good for family dogs or for working dogs. People use them for all sorts of stuff. The next one I'm going to be talking about, which is one of the other Fab Four, is Smooth and Rough Collies. So before doing a ton of research, I like didn't even really know about Smooth and Rough Collies. I feel like they're not a super common breed. Some things to keep in mind about Smooth and Rough Collies are they can be shy. They're known to genetically be shyer, more timid dogs, and you really want a confident dog for service dog stuff. So just make sure you're looking into the bloodlines. They're also known to be a more sensitive breed. Something that's really nice about them is they're known to be a one-person dog, and that's awesome for a service dog because you want them to have a super strong bond with their handler. That is really good. The Smooth Collies have lower maintenance coats.
All right, lower maintenance coat. Why does it sound wrong?
But the Rough Collies generally have a little bit more higher maintenance coats just because of how they're bred. Smooth and Rough Collies are generally recommended for more experienced dog owners, but I think it really depends. The final one of the Fab Four, my personal favorite.
I'm a little biased, but.
Standard Poodles. Standard Poodles are actually the second smartest dog in the world, right below Border Collies. That is, you know, that's awesome. You obviously want a smart dog who's gonna learn really easy, so there's
smartness, their smartness? Their smartness makes them trainable. Smartness?
That does not sound like a word. I don't know how to talk, so that's good. But anyways, they are very trainable because they're so smart. Like I said, the second smartest dog in the world. That being said, they can be stubborn because they are so smart. Sometimes I think Finnegan is smarter than me, and that can be a great thing, but it can also be a little bit challenging. So an example is like if I ask Finn to do something, but I do the cue wrong, like he's like, no, like you didn't ask me to do that, right? Like I'm not gonna do that because you didn't, like you messed up. He's just so smart and he uses that to his advantage, and it can be really awesome, but it can also be challenging. My battery is blinking.
Hold on, let me change the battery.
Okay, I'm gonna change the battery really quick.
Really quick, be right back.
I'm back. Sorry if the angle changed. So let's get right back into it. We were talking about standard poodles. So.
Is this crooked?
Who? Roller coaster. They can also be really sensitive, so they can be very emotional, which can be really good, but it can also be like a little bit challenging. So something else to think about is that they require a lot of grooming. That is something that I personally, I've been learning how to groom, but I'm not great at it. I'm learning. There's definitely been a couple bald spots, but it's okay. But they do require to be brushed almost daily. I would say that they are, from my experience, pretty calm. If they're a puppy, they're still gonna act like a puppy. But I feel like generally speaking, Finnegan is a pretty like good and calm puppy. I'm sure there are a lot of poodle owners who are like,
what are you talking about? My dog is crazy.
From my experience, they can be relatively calm, which can be super awesome if you're disabled. Those are the Fab Four. Now we're gonna talk about other common breeds for service dog work. I think it's super, super important to stick to the Fab Four. They are common and popular for a reason because they're successful. So keep that in mind. German Shepherds are another one that people think about a lot. They're super, super smart dogs. They're very smart and they don't have a ton of grooming maintenance, which is really nice. They have a high drive. They can be super awesome dogs. They can be great for medical alert dogs, but if you need a psychiatric service dog, a German Shepherd is probably not the right choice for you, just because they're known to like feed off their handler's emotions and they can be kind of higher strung. So definitely not a great choice for psychiatric service dogs, generally speaking. Another one, which is more common than you might think, is Huskies. I'm not trying to offend you, and if you have a service dog who is a Husky, that's awesome, good for you. But Huskies are definitely not a great choice, generally speaking, for service dogs, just because they are very, very energetic and they can be high strung and they're very vocal and they can be really mouthy. Probably not a great choice to go with a Husky. I know they're gorgeous and they're awesome dogs, but just not a great choice, generally speaking, for service dog work. Border Collies are the next one. They are actually, I'm pretty sure, like the first smartest dog in the whole world. So they're really, really smart. Something about that is herding breeds can be a challenge for service dog work. They have such a high prey drive, which can be challenging, and they're also super energetic generally. That being said, Border Collies are super, super, super smart, and they can still definitely make successful service dogs. The next common breed is Doodles. So the Doodle was created so it could be the best of both worlds, because you have a poodle, which is awesome, and a golden or a lab, and you put them together and you get the perfect dog. That was kind of their intention with the Doodles. A lot of times they still shed, so that's kind of one of the like points people make, is they're like, I want a Doodle because they won't shed. Obviously all breeds can have health issues, but the breeding behind Doodles is a little bit questionable in my opinion. I'm not saying there's never gonna be a reputable Doodle breeder. I would say avoid Doodles. And I know so many people that have Doodles and they're successful service dogs, and that's amazing, but if you're gonna get a Doodle, just be really super careful with the breeder. I know that Doodles are gorgeous and they're super smart, but there can definitely be some weird stuff going on with the genetics behind Doodles, but that's always kind of a gamble when talking about Doodles. You just never know what you're gonna get. That being said, like I said, like they have been successful service dogs for a ton of people. So another thing I just wanted to touch on is smaller breeds for service dog work. The number one smaller breed for service dog work would be toy poodles, because they're pretty much a poodle but smaller. And then if you need like a really heavy mobility dog, Great Danes have been also pretty successful. Look into the bloodlines and the parents to make sure the dog is gonna fit like the size requirements you need if you need mobility. So the bottom line when you're choosing a breed for service dog work is to keep in mind what you need and you want to set yourself up for success. Keep that in mind. Also, like something that can irritate me personally is when people go and choose an off breed and then they wash them out because they didn't work out for service dog work, because they're literally being what they were bred for. Like they are being what they are as a breed, and then people like are like, oh,
didn't work out for a service dog.
Well then like maybe you shouldn't have gotten that breed in the beginning. I think the bottom line is just to keep in mind what you need and definitely make sure the breeder is reputable. Even if you do everything right, something can still go wrong, so just keep that in mind. Wow, that sounds really like terrible. And like, you can do everything right
and it can still suck. Like, oh.
Also, I just wanted to say thank you guys for 200 subscribers. Yay, it's small but mighty, woohoo. If you guys enjoyed this video, you can like it and subscribe to my channel. One thing I did want to say before we end it is I've been getting comments on my video. I don't know how to say this like nicely. I've been getting comments that are not super
kind.
I just wanted to say, just a reminder is think before you comment. If you're gonna comment something, keep it like kind, and I want the comment section to be like a supportive, good environment. I feel like a lot of people subscribe to me are disabled people, so like I want this to be like a good, positive, supportive environment. Think before you speak, think before you comment. I just wanted to say that just to kind of remind you guys. If you want to comment something though, definitely do comment something. I will definitely respond to you, so comment something. Thank you guys so much for watching, and I will see you in the next video. You're awesome, you rock, goodbye. Bye. I know you're somewhere, somewhere. I'm trapped in my